Meredith Steeler, welcome.
Welcome. No, thank you.
I guess still got some nerves over there, huh?
Yeah.
Well, thanks for...
social anxiety. That's my forte.
Hey, whatever works, you know. Thanks for taking time out of your busy schedule. You know, cows never stop. That's nope. A schedule. That's 2 days, two times a day, 7 days a week, and it doesn't matter if you're sick, hungover. You've never been there before,
no,
right?
No, of course not. My barn could talk. I'd be in trouble.
Oh gosh, I'm sure that barn could tell some stories, though.
Yeah. A lot of stories I don't think I'd want repeated.
Yeah, I remember going to Brandon's one time when he was still milking, and of course, you went out the night before, you know, and that morning, yeah. You're like, oh, my God. Like, today is never going to end. Mm-hmm. So, obviously, you're a dairy farmer.
Mm-hmm.
Obviously, you've been in that industry since you were wee little.
Basically, since I could walk, yeah. Mm-hmm. Even in the womb.
It's kind of in your blood, then, yeah. Basically, is what you're telling me. How many cows are you guys milking?
52.
Yep. And that's what the barn holds, I'm assuming,
yep.
Correct?
That's what the barn holds.
That barn, we had this conversation earlier, but that barn seems bigger than that.
It is. Well, not really, but when you're... the one doing the work and everything, it's like, goddamn, this part never ends.
It's like, oh, I'm only half done? What? Especially on those mornings or mm-hmm. or whatever. It's just endless, it seems. How many milkers do you guys run at a time then?
We run 5 units and we've got 1 bucket milker.
So. And the bucket milker is for...
bucket milkers for fresh cows or cows that we treat when they're sick. So that, like, the treated milk either gets dumped or, like, does not go in the tank at all.
Yeah, because of
antibiotics.
Correct. Yeah. Thank you. That's the word I was looking for in my brain. See, my brain's not working today either.
That's all right.
Yeah, because your milk has to be antibiotic free,
mm-hmm.
but when it's on the farm, mm-hmm. before it leaves the farm, even. Mm-hmm.
And if you get caught with it, it's a very bad problem.
Yeah. Well, you gotta dump that whole tank, correct?
And then you gotta pay for the tank if you're the one that made the screw up.
Into the truck you're talking about.
Yeah.
Once it gets into the truck.
Like, you don't just have to pay for your tank, you might have to pay for like 10 other farms that just got picked up and
yeah, it's a serious thing.
Oh yeah.
Yeah. Because I've never actually seen a bulk tank get dumped because antibiotics were put into it, but I've heard stories, and it's a serious thing. You want that milk as pure as it can possibly be when it goes into mm-hmm. your bulk tank. So when it goes into the truck tank, when the semi comes to pick up your milk, you want to make sure that's absolutely clean. How big is your guys' bulk tank?
I think the bulk tank holds about 4,000 pounds.
So I
believe it's a 600 gallon tank.
Okay. Are you an everyday pickup? Every other day pickup? Every day?
Yeah.
Yeah, I didn't know how. I know some farms are every day, some farms are every other day, depending on how big your bulk tank is and blah, 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 blah. Yeah. So that's.
Right now we're shipping about 3,750. Every day on 52 cows.
Wow, that's great.
And in the summer, that is really good.
What are you guys averaging per cow, per pound, pounds per cow?
The average right now is about 80 to 85.
That's wonderful.
Yeah.
That's impressive.
Yeah.
That's great.
It's good stuff.
Well, I mean, it takes a lot to get your cows to peel. To be able to produce that.
Yeah.
Why don't you go into some of the things that you guys are got it? I mean, right feed mixture, facilities, I'm assuming, to be able to get that produced. Because cows can be very finicky.
Oh, yeah, especially ours.
Well, I'm saying like in the summertime when it's hot, obviously, your milk production is going to drop.
Oh, yeah.
So what are some of the things that you guys do on your farm to help keep your cows to sustain that level?
So we feed TMR, total mixed ration, and we work with our nutritionist very closely. He actually comes out once a month, kind of does a once over of the cows. We'll do a test on the feed if we're in a new bag just to make sure if we need to adjust the ration. And we are constantly going back and forth of telling him, like, if we've noticed some issues of, like, what the consistency of the manure is, or if he, like, sees something. Because we look at our cows every day. There's a term called barn blindness that I know I fall guilty of it.
Go into a little detail on that. I've never heard that before.
It's just, like, I might not notice a cow is off, like, just because I stare at her every single day. And then he'll come in and be like, hey, like, did you notice that cow's got, like, a sore foot? Or did you see that she's got, like, kind of arched up in the back? And
gotcha.
Like, whereas I'm, like, looking at 52 cows, like, every single day. And I'm like, I know it's doesn't seem like a lot, but when you've got 500 things going through your head, it's very simple to kind of overlook the cow that has an arched back or kind of limping or whatever.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And so that's kind of nice, just having that extra set of eyes. Just
yeah, that's great that he, like you said, that nutritionist can come in and, yeah, and go, hey, what's going on with her? What's yeah. going on with her? I noticed the last time I was here, she wasn't doing this, or yeah. now she's doing that. Yeah. What do we got to do to yeah. to help remedy those things?
Or, like, overall, like, the entire herd, every once in a while, like, he'll point out if I'm behind on pouring the herd for, like, lice or something. He's like, you got to do that. I'm like, it's on the list. I just haven't gotten that far. And he's like, no, it's getting pretty bad. Like, you got to do it. I'm like, okay,
I guess it's the top priority on the list now.
Yeah, so that is nice because he'll just come out and point out, like, you know, last month they're kind of looking a little skinnier, a little wrung out than they were the last time I was here. And he's like, what's going on? And then you kind of tell him, he's like, okay, so it's not a feed issue, it's just something else, like weather-wise, or you just calved in like 30 animals like I did 3 weeks ago.
Oh, really?
Yeah, that was fun.
Wow, 30.
That's more than half my barn.
I was going to say, that's more than half your herd that you got. Well, half the barn that you're milking. 30 of them. Wow. So what's the, since you jumped onto that topic, how long can you milk a cow before you need to breed her again? Is there a specific date, time?
The industry standard, I believe, is still 60 days from, like, when she calves to when you can start breeding again, which I personally, it all kind of depends on the cow. Like, our high producers, I actually go a little longer because I've just realized that our high producers, when you breed them kind of in that 60-day range, you're drying them up, and they're still making, like, 90 pounds when you dry them up. So then you just kind of end up having to retreat them because dry them up, and they're leaking 2 days later. So for the heavy producers, I kind of wait for that 70 to 80-day range, maybe 95, just depending on the cow.
Yeah. Yeah, I'm sure every cow's a little bit different.
Yeah. And then the two-year-olds, I usually kind of get them bred back right away. And then there's always those certain cows that just don't want to get bred. And
I think every dairy farm has a few of those cows.
Oh yeah.
Where it doesn't matter what you do, you're like, well, I'm just going to keep trying until I get it.
Yep.
Cause I'm assuming you guys, AI everything, right?
Mm-hmm.
Do you pretty well do all that?
Yeah. I breed everything.
That probably took a little practice, huh?
Yeah. I still remember when I was up at short course taking the class, I was getting so, like, irritated because I couldn't figure it out. And we were working on cows that weren't technically in heat. And I'm like, dude, I can't get through. Like, I was getting so mad. And I was like, I need to learn how to do this because it's costing me money and I want to save money.
Yeah, if you can do it yourself, it's huge savings.
Yeah.
Huge savings. Mm-hmm. Plus, and we'll get into this in a little while, but if you do it yourself, you know, first of all, you know your cows.
Yeah.
So you know, okay, I know this cow usually breeds back okay. I know this cow's a stickler. I know blah, 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 blah. And then you can also pick and choose your own semen.
Yeah.
And what you want to breed, what cow to, what whatever bull that semen that you buy. So I'm assuming you have a semen salesman that come around and you can pick and choose whatever bulls and stuff that you want from them.
Yep. We've got about four to five that are pretty consistent with stopping in every 2-3 months. And I always feel bad because a lot of times I'll go with, like, they've got nice bowls, but I know I can't personally use them, and I'm still trying to clean out the tank from bowls that I've bought before. Like, 50-cow herd, you buy 20 units of semen at one time. It's like, that's going to last you a while.
It's going to last you a while.
So I always feel bad because they stop in. They're like, do you need anything? It's like, well, yeah, I want stuff. But I don't need it.
It's like, ooh, that's pretty, but... God, I got a lot left over I got to get taken care of yet.
Exactly.
Where do you keep your semen that you buy from them?
We've got a semen tank. It's filled with liquid nitrogen, which is, I should know, this is a dairy bowl question.
It is. That's why I'm asking.
It's very cold. Negative.
Yeah, I'll have to look it up. It's like negative.
It's like.
Yeah, I was going to say 230 degrees or something. It freezes that stuff now.
If you touch it with wet fingers, you're a little in trouble.
It burns.
Oh, yeah.
It's so cold, it burns.
I got it in my eye one time when I was doing, went to go grab
How
a straw.
How did you get in your eye?
I couldn't read.
I'm laughing with you, I promise.
Yeah, I was a little scared. I was like, oh, that hurts.
And how many sticks can you keep in those things? I've seen them a bunch of times. They're basically like a 3-foot round steel casing.
Yeah.
And then it kind of comes to a narrow top on it, right?
Yeah.
And then they hang from that top, if I'm not mistaken, correct? Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Which, a lot of the canisters.
Canisters, thank you. That was the word I was looking for.
Welcome. Ours probably holds about, I think right now I have 80 straws in there, maybe a little more, give or take.
And one straw will do one AI on one cow, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. So you can breed, theoretically, you could breed up to 80 cows with what you have on hand.
Yeah.
And it's always good to have it on hand because if a cow comes in heat tomorrow, you can call your semen and say, hey, I got one in heat, get over here now. No. You just walk over, pop it open, grab whatever stick that you want to breed with that cow. And get it done. The AI is a good thing to know if you're in the dairy industry.
Yeah,
because that like we talked about all the pros on those, and it's a great what's your sticking percentage? Do you know?
That I do not know. I know I've gotten better at it.
Well, I would hope so. you probably do what? Five, six a month or more?
Depending on the time of year, it's usually in that 5-6 a month, and then there's times where I do like 20.
Hence why you just calved in 30, right?
Yeah. We classified the other day, and the classifier, he he asked a bunch of fresh dates on cows, and it was like all of them that I calved in. He's like, "You were busy a couple weeks ago, weren't you?" Yeah.
Well,
I'm forever guilty of, "Oh, she's in heat, let's breed her," and not think 9 months later what's going to happen.
And all of a sudden, like, "Oh, no. I got 30 of them that are coming in this month. It's going to be a long month, let me tell you." Mm-hmm. And just think, some of these bigger dairies, that's every day.
Yeah.
You guys are milking 52 cows. Think about these dairies that are milking 500.
Yeah. Like, I calve in 2 or 3 a day. I'm exhausted.
Yeah. And these guys, you know, they got 500 cows that they're milking, mm-hmm. which means at least 1 a day. It could be 2 a day, 3 a day, 5 a day, 10 a day. Mm-hmm. And they're doing that every day. Mm-hmm. Oh, I don't even want to think about that. That's a headache all on its own.
Yeah, fresh cows are, if they get off to the right start and they're off to the races, they're fine. But the ones that you got troubles with, it's like, oh, man, I got to baby you.
And the calves, too, right? Yeah. Now you got to take care of calves, mm-hmm. and you got to make sure that they're milking, or they're not milking, but they're drinking milk mm-hmm. the right way, and some of them don't want to do that, and mm-hmm. it's a mm-hmm. complete cluster. It can be.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, you brought it up, classifying. So I want to talk a little bit about that, because I don't know a whole lot about it. And from your last Facebook post when you guys did it, it sounds like you're doing a really good job over there. Take me through classified. What is that?
Classification, that is a service that is provided by the Holstein Association, where someone comes out, unbiased opinion, and basically just evaluates your cows. So if you were to go out and sell them, if you've got a 90-point cow compared to an 85-point cow, whether she's,
I'm assuming this is rated out of 100 then? 100 is, like, the best?
Yeah, but you can't have 100. Like, the breakdown, I think, for an excellent cow is 90 to 97. So, okay. But when you're actually, like, scoring the cow, like, the breakdown for that is 100. But the cow can only go 97.
Okay. Makes sense. So,
yeah. Like, if you were to market one of your cows, like, if you've got a 90-point cow compared to, like, an 85-point cow, they're both the same age, depending on who you're trying to please. If it's a type person, they're going to want the 90-point cow, whereas if you're just trying to please the average farmer that just wants a nice cow that's going to put milk in their tank and last a little bit longer, and they don't really care if it's a cow that can go out and win a show, they'll be more apt to buy the 85-point cow.
Gotcha. Makes sense. So it's just based on rating how that cow looks then.
Yeah.
So does it have anything to do with milk production at that point in time or no?
No, not necessarily, but it kind of plays a little bit into it. If you've got a cow that is only milking like 50, 60 pounds, and you try to bag her, like, you're not going to get much there compared to a cow that's milking, like, 120 pounds, and you can bag her, and it's just, like, that the udder is just, like, boom,
the udder is
right
there.
In
Bam.
Your face. And
yeah.
It's like, ooh, I like that.
Because they correct me if I'm wrong. I've been wrong before, so.
I've been wrong before.
When they look to see how straight the legs are, how the hips look, what the udder looks like, if it's nice and uniform. What else do they check for when they're classifying?
It's udder, feet and legs, dairy strength, dairy form, like openness to rib. Like, do they have the strength? Do they have, how tall are they? We actually scored a cow. She actually got docked for being a little too tall, which I'm not going to argue the guy. She actually is kind of
too tall.
Yeah. Especially standing next to me. I'm 5'4", and she's like already towering over me, and she's just a 2-year-old. And it's like, yeah, I'm not going to argue with that. She is a little tall.
Probably makes it a little nicer to milk, though.
Oh, yeah.
Don't have to bend down near as far. Yeah, I know. I've seen some cows with some huge udders, you know, and mm-hmm. they're this far off the ground, you're like, oh man, I gotta go way down there. Yep. But you guys, it sounded like your classification went well for your herd.
Correct? Yeah, we classified 36 cows, 34 jumped in points. We had 7 new excellents, 1 excellent 91, a 90 jumped to 91. We had a 2-year-old go very good, 88, which is very hard to do. We had another 2-year-old that's technically not 2 for, I think, a week. She went 85, which is also very hard to do. And then we had a lot of 86 to 88 point second plus lactation cows that are just jumping in points.
That's wonderful.
Yeah.
So there could come a time, and maybe you do this now, I don't know. There could come a time where you could sell the eggs.
Yeah.
Out of the cow. Mm-hmm. Do you do that now?
I don't do it now, but that's kind of what I'm working towards. I'm still trying to build the pedigree because we don't go out and show. Like, we're kind of a no-name. Like, I'm pretty sure everyone kind of looks at us as a piss-on. Like,
no. Wow. After this, I mean, hearing what you're herd classified, I would disagree with that.
Yeah, I've had a lot of people tell me that, but I'm also a very humble person, so.
Yeah, you are.
I try not to brag. It was actually funny. The nutritionist, he was out probably a week before we scored, and I was telling him about these 2 2-year-olds that I'm, like, kind of really excited for them. They look really good, and, like kind of tooting my own horn about it, and I literally got done with it. I'm like, sorry, I didn't mean to do that.
You have to, though. You need to be proud of that. Well, think about it. I mean, you're seeing these cows twice a day, 365. Doesn't mm-hmm. matter. So if you're building the pedigree, which means you're putting the right bulls with the right cows mm-hmm. to make a better calf, yeah. that's something to toot yeah. your own horn on. Yeah. That's, you should yeah. be extremely proud of that, because I'm not going to say not a lot of people don't do that, but to start where you guys started and to see that now, you're doing something right.
Yeah.
So you need brag, shit, brag. I mean, be pumped about it.
Yeah.
You know, you should be. That's what I'm getting at. Is that's an awesome accomplishment. And just imagine if you keep going the direction that you're going. There's endless avenues in what you can do, what your cows can do.
Oh yeah.
Where you can sell it. I mean. Yeah. With technology nowadays, you might be shipping stuff all the way out to California.
That would be pretty cool.
That'd be pretty cool.
Yeah.
Maybe not today, maybe not tomorrow, but who knows what 10 years brings.
Yeah, that's kind of what I'm working towards. I was actually talking to someone about this the other day. It's like, I don't necessarily, like, want to go out and show the cows, just because I don't like being in the spotlight. Like, that's not my thing. I kind of like being behind the scenes, just making sure everything's taken care of, and just want to be proud of the product that I put out there.
Absolutely.
And it's like, I'm more content with just having a nice barn full of just consistent cows, where if someone wants to come in and show them, buy them, show them, whatever, I'm perfectly okay with that. Like, I don't necessarily need to be out in the spotlight, which is funny because my, like, lifelong dream, which I'm pretty sure is every dairy farmer's lifelong dream, is to go up and win Expo at Madison. It's like, well, you got to get out there and show if you want to do that.
That you do. But the cool part about it is you live in an area, we live in an area, where there are shows you can go to that aren't far.
Yeah.
I mean, Madison's only... I mean, by the time you load cows and stuff up and take up there, you know, it's an hour and a half. But still, that's not that far.
Yeah.
In the realm of things. You know, there's five different fairs in the area where mm-hmm. if all of a sudden you get this one cow and you go, man, she's going to be really something.
Yeah.
Okay. I might have to take time to run up to the local fairs here and show her to see how I do.
Yeah.
And then who knows? Maybe end up going up to Madison and fulfilling your lifelong dream.
That would be pretty.
It's just something, but you got to start.
Yeah, that's what everyone tells me.
You got to take the time to do that stuff, too. Yeah, I get it. Like I said, cows are very needy animals, but mm-hmm. sometimes you got to take the time to do what you want to do too.
Yeah.
So we were talking about this earlier, with classification, that's basically on selling the cow and or the eggs out of her.
Yeah.
But that doesn't always, if you're in the situation that you're in now, where you're not doing that yet, you still gotta produce milk. Yeah. Because at the end of the day, that's what's gonna pay the bills.
Just because I have 9-point cow doesn't mean I'm gonna get paid extra for my milk.
Exactly. So you gotta try to find that fine line too. Because I mean, it's great to have an excellent cow. It's awesome. Yeah. You know, 90 plus. But if she's only, like you said, she's only putting out 65 pounds, well, son of a gun, we got, you know, the feed I'm putting in her is way more than 65 pounds a day. So, mm-hmm. So you got to try to find that fine line too, to be able to pay the bills.
Yeah.
You know, but if you're averaging, you know, 80, 85 throughout your herd, that's great.
Yeah.
That's great.
And that's the other thing when I'm looking at bull proofs to breed, like, I'm very meticulous about what I pick for bulls. Like, basically every semen salesman that has walked through my barn and dealt with me for when I go to buy semen, they flat out tell me I am picky as fuck.
Well, you should. I mean, these are your cows. You're trying to, like you said, update that pedigree, mm-hmm. try to get them better. You should be as picky as you want to be.
Yeah.
And I'm sure there are certain bulls that don't work on your farm mm-hmm. because of whatever reason. You'll know that more than me. Yeah. Why do some bulls, since I brought it up, why do some bulls not work on your farm compared to other ones?
For us personally.
Yeah, I mean, that's what I'm talking about. I'm talking about your farm. I'm not talking about industry standard. I'm talking about on your operation. Yeah. Why? Because you're going to know. I mean, I don't.
Well, to put it simple, when you try to put modern-day genetics in a barn that's 70 years old, it's don't work well. Which a lot of bulls now, I've noticed over the years, which it's kind of funny because the breed kind of goes in waves. A couple years ago, we had the same exact problem. People are starting to build giraffes again. Like, they want their show cows to be, like, giraffe height. It's like, okay, well, my barn doesn't house a giraffe. Like,
well, part of your barn does.
Yeah, part of the barn does. Because
if I'm not mistaken, you got really low ceilings on one side, and then you added on to it, or somebody added on to it, and those are really high ceilings on mm-hmm. the other side, if I'm not mistaken.
Yeah. Yep. Yeah. The low ceiling part, which when you have, like, even now, and I'm still making sure, like, I won't buy a bull if it's over 3 points for stature, because I know it's not going to fit in our barn.
What does that mean? In
like, how tall?
Dumb terms.
How tall they're going to be.
Oh, okay. So 3 point is very tall?
Well, right now, it's actually kind of average.
Okay.
There's a couple bulls out there that are averaging, like, 4 and 5 points for stature, so it's, like, they're, like, top notch.
Very
gonna
tall.
Be, yeah. Gonna be giraffes. And like I said, I'm only buying bulls that are 2, 2.5, maybe 3 points. Because I do have some short cows just because they're not big families. So every once in a while I'll buy a bull that's 3 points on stature. But a lot of times the 2-year-olds that we're calving in, it's just like, shush. You guys could technically be in the new barn. Like, that's not supposed to be that way.
How do you keep that all straight? Like, the genetic side of things. Because, I mean, each cow in there could be related at some point. But, I mean, do you have that all memorized in your head? Or do you have to spread it out, like, on a spreadsheet? And go, okay, Dorothy over here is such and such, and Mary over here is such and such. Because I mean, I'm assuming you name your cows.
Yeah.
Yep. So, do you do that, or is it all basically up here? Like, I know she came from her, and we used this bull on her to make that, and then her calf, we used a bull on to make.
It's a little bit of both. For the most part, a lot of it is up in my head, and then as we get kind of farther back into the generations, it's like, okay, that now I got certain stuff down because everything commingles.
Yeah, because I know when I worked for the local dairy farm down the road here when I was younger, there was two of them that was on the farm. The dad, who at that point in time was late 60s, early 70s, and then their kid was in the early 30s. And, of course, I was a teenager, but they knew it. I mean, oh, yeah, well, you know, Dolly over here came from Dorothy, and Dorothy came from Deanna, and I was just like, they look nothing alike, you know? But they just knew it, and
yeah.
I was assuming that, you know, with you trying to build your pedigrees and stuff, I was assuming you probably knew a lot of it, but I didn't know if you had a spreadsheet out there where you can go back and double-check everything to make sure that your brain's right.
Yeah. You kind of technically do have a spreadsheet with when you register your cows. Like, they go back 3 generations on the paper itself, so you've got a reminder as you're looking at the paper, and then just as you go farther back into the papers, you've got more 3 generations, and so you can always kind of figure stuff out.
Yeah. When you classify, is that like through the Holstein place, is that like public knowledge? Or can another dairy farm look at your pedigrees and look at your classification, and can you do that to somebody else, or is that pretty well just...
I believe they recently changed that. Because you always used to be able to do it, but I think now they only allow the farm to look at the pedigrees.
Okay.
Because I actually just had to make an account to go, because someone asked us how many cows, like how many excellent cows we've bred so far, and I went to go log into Holstein to like check to see, and I actually had to make an account to look at my own personal cows.
Gotcha.
I'm like, oh, when did that change? Because before, you used to just be able to type in someone's prefix, and then you'd see everyone's, what their cows have been doing. Well, so I don't know when that changed.
Yeah, I just was curious because, you know, if later on down the road you want to start selling cows and things like that, it'd be really cool if they could be, you know, somebody from California, like I said, could look up online and go, hey, what's this small farming operation out here in Illinois? Wow, they got some excellent cows. Maybe we ought to give them a call.
Yeah.
Otherwise, now it sounds like you're going to have to advertise your cows when it comes to that point.
Yeah. Yeah. You've got to personally advertise your cows. And if you do put them on a sale, they make up catalogs. So then the pedigree information is public in the catalog so everyone can see it. But like I said, we're kind of a no-name farm. So... if I were to put something on a sale, like, I want to make sure that I've got the pedigree behind it because no one knows my name. It's just...
Well, around here, you're very, very popular around here. The last name is very popular around here. But like you said, you get out away from this area. It's no different than everybody. Everybody knows everybody around here.
Yeah.
But you go 300 miles from here, and they're going to say, Kyle? Who the f*** is Kyle?
Exactly.
It's just the way it is. So when that time comes and you do well, you will have to advertise your own cattle then.
Yep.
And there's different ways to do that, I'm assuming?
Yeah. You can always use Facebook or...
social media.
Yeah, social media. Actually go out and show the cows and have people do it that way. And there is a place up in Whitewater, Sunshine Genetics, if you flush with them, I believe they will help you market.
That's cool.
I believe. They always used to. I don't know if they still do. I think they do, but I'm not sure.
That's okay. Something new.
Yeah.
On your farm, you guys have 52 stalls in your barn, so it's not like a carousel or a parlor or anything like that. Cause those do make a difference, right? Mm-hmm. I mean, the parlors, you know, they're big, you are below the cow So the cows are up 4 feet or whatever, and you can milk them from that direction or milk them from the bottom, where in your situation, you're milking them from the top. Shit. Forgot where I was going to go with that. So you guys, the cows, when, as soon as, do you feed them in the barn or do you feed them out of the barn?
That depends on the time of year.
So I'm assuming in the wintertime you feed them in the barn then?
Yeah.
Do you keep the cows in the barn all the time in the wintertime?
Yeah. They go out for a couple hours in the morning if weather permits so we can clean the barn and just give them a nice new place to sleep.
Yeah, because that chores in the wintertime.
They're not fun.
Takes a substantial amount of time.
When we went through that really bad cold snap, snow storm, whatever it was, on, like, Christmas. Yeah, that we were in the barn basically 24 hours for that whole entire time that we were in those negative 20-degree days.
Because cows produce a lot of body heat.
Mm-hmm.
So they can keep the barn, usually they can keep the barn warm enough.
Yeah.
So no pipes freeze, everything.
We still had pipes
freeze. Well, you're going to have pipes freeze, but probably outside the barn, not in the barn.
No,
in the barn too, huh?
In the barn too.
Oof.
That northwest side in the winter. Oof.
Terrible, huh?
It's not fun. Even the slightest breeze, like it could be 20 degrees out and you've got a slight breeze, you still got frozen water cups.
No kidding.
Yeah.
That sucks.
Yeah.
That sucks. Because I was going to say, in the summertime, you literally bring the cows in, get them in their stalls, milk them.
Kick them back out.
So there's not a whole lot of extra chores that you need to do in the summertime as far as in the barn goes. I mean, you still got to clean the barn. You still got to clean your pipes. If anything's broke, you're going to have to fix those things. But the cows aren't in there then. They're gone. So you got free range to do whatever. But in the wintertime, how do you guys do your – I mean, do you guys use straw, sawdust, straw? And then obviously you feed them up in the manger then, up in the front?
Yep.
And that's all by hand?
Yep. Which I'm not the one that does that. David does.
Go David.
Yeah.
Shout out to you.
Oh, yeah.
But that can wintertime definitely throws a curveball in things.
Oh, yeah.
This podcast episode is sponsored by Dan's Diesel Performance. If you're looking to improve your truck's performance, efficiency, or appearance, check out Dan's Diesel Performance. They manufacture turbochargers, fuel injectors, fuel pumps, transmissions, intake piping, and much, much more. Plus, they offer all the top brands in the diesel industry. They're located in McChesney Park, Illinois. Visit their website at dansdieselperformance.com or give them a call at 815-977-5865.
But we've also got tunnel ventilation.
Explain that.
So tunnel ventilation for us, we've got 4 fans on the north end of the barn, and basically all it does is just pull air through. So like in the summer, technically when everyone still has their cows out on pasture, like I have to bring mine in at like 2 in the afternoon because they know it's nicer in the barn than it is outside, which works in my favor because when cows are comfy, they produce milk. So I'll do that, and then in the winter, because our cows have to stay in for so long, you're pulling out that nasty air, and you're bringing fresh air in, so that helps with pneumonia problems. But on the really bad days, when it's like negative 20 with a 50-degree wind chill, you can't run your fans, so.
Yeah, it is what it is at that point.
Yeah. Just try to make things work the best you can.
'Cause cows can catch pneumonia.
Oh, yeah.
That quick.
Mm-hmm.
Why?
I'm trying to figure that one out.
I mean, I think fluctuation in weather can do that.
Yeah.
Which is weird.
Yeah, it's crazy because cows, they can't handle a fluctuation. Like, if it's going to be hot, it needs to stay hot. If it's going to be cold, it needs to stay cold. It can't be hot, cold, hot, cold, hot, cold. Like, they do not thrive in that, and that's when you get all your problems. But someone asked me the other day how the cows have been maintaining through the summer with the heat, and I'm like, honestly, they've been doing okay because it can get hot during the day, but as long as it cools off at night to, like, 65, 60, like, it gives them that relief. So they are getting that relief at night, and then they can kind of hang out a little more longer during the day when it's hot, but when you don't get that relief at night, you notice it, which I was really scared because we went through another hot spell, I think a week before we scored, and they weren't going to get that relief at night like they had been. And I'm like, well, this is the first time they've been going through it. Like, I didn't know if they were going to crash and burn from it or not, and I was a little scared, but they held their own.
They held their own. They held their own.
Yeah.
What you guys have a couple different pastures out back? Is it just one big pasture that you send them out to?
It's one big pasture for the milk cows, and then our dry cows kind of have a little exercise paddock
that okay.
they go out in.
Dry cows.
Yeah.
Why are they called dry cows?
They're not producing milk.
And why are they not producing milk?
Because they're on maternity leave.
So they get a little break from yeah. the milk in action. And you said earlier, I think it's about 9 months.
Yeah. That's how long the gestation is for a dry cow.
And but you milk the pregnant cows for how long usually before you dry them up?
We dry them up about when they're 7 months pregnant. So they get like a 2 month window of just kind of getting ready for their next lactation. And if they were sick or had like a high cell count, we'll treat them for that when they dry up. So hopefully when they calve in again, we can address the problem and it won't be as bad. And just kind of give them a time to just relax. And because producing milk is hard for humans and cows,
for everybody.
I can't say it's hard
for women. Yeah, for the female mammals out there.
I know it's a hard job. Can't speak for myself, but from other people that have told me, and from dealing with cows, it's not a fun job.
I can't speak for myself on that one either. I'll just take your word on it. What's the process to drying up a cow?
The process would be I personally, just because I always end up having to retreat cows. So I try to get them in that, like, 50-pound range, whereas if I dry, because we pretty much just abruptly dry our cows up, milk them one morning, dry them up, give them their antibiotics, seal them, kick them out to the dry cow pasture.
What do you mean by seal them?
We've got, like, a product that we use that we buy from one of our semen salesmen. It's just, like, a teat dip that, like, actually seals the teat. So you're not, like, getting dirt, manure, anything up there in the teat canal. Like, if they do start leaking or whatever, like, you're not getting all that nasty stuff up there.
Yeah, yeah. So they're milking 50 pounds a day, and you're like, okay, well, they're 7 months pregnant. It's time to dry them up. Yeah. So you seal the teat up, kick them out to the pasture, and then you wait till they calve, right?
Mm-hmm.
Pretty simple process then.
Yeah.
But when you seal that teat up, then nothing can get in there.
Yeah.
So there's no infection. There's nothing like that can happen to the cow. It's just another day without producing milk.
Yeah. Which, like I said, we've had cows leak before, so I'll have to come back and milk them in the bucket because I've treated them with antibiotics, and just re-dry them up again and start the process over.
The other thing I want to touch base on here is as far as the quality of the milk. So just because you're putting milk into your bulk tank that doesn't have antibiotics or anything like that in it, there's still a standard, a quality standard that you have as far as things like cell count. Can you explain what cell count is?
So cell count, that's basically just telling you how many like white blood cells are in the cow's udder, which if it's a lot, you're going to have a higher cell count because the cow's either trying to fight infection or she's got a bad foot or she's got another like issue and she's just trying to fight itself. So you kind of got to figure out, it's like, well, is it a mastitis problem? Is it a foot problem? Is it, did she calve in and she didn't clean right? So now she's got infection in the uterus. So it's a lot of playing around with the vet and playing around when you're milking, just making sure like everything's kosher there. And we use a product called Udder Comfort. It's a lotion that helps take the edema out, which is swelling in the udder. And for the most part, it stuff works really well. Like, I will swear by that stuff. I actually use it on myself for my back pain. Like, it works.
That's when you know it works. Like, oh, I'm going to feel better now.
Uh-huh. It was funny. There was one night I was milking when it was really hot out and I was dripping sweat. Like, I'm a sweaty person to begin with, but I got it. I forgot where I put it, but I put it somewhere and I'm like, oh, it feels so nice and cool. Like, that's when you know it's hot, because normally when you put it on your skin, like, the stuff burns. Like, it's kind of powerful stuff because it's got peppermint oil and just another, because, like, it's designed to pull the swelling out, so that's what it's trying to do. And usually when you put it on your skin, it's like, oh, that kind of burns.
And being that it was cool, you're like, what is going on here?
I'm like, that's when you know it's hot. I remember one time Kevin was milking with us, and he went to the bathroom after using the stuff, and he came back. He's like, oh, my God. I'm like, yeah, you might want to wash that.
Oops. Uh-huh. Yeah, I could see that happening. I could see that happening really easy if mm-hmm. if you don't pay attention to that. Mm-hmm. What is the definition of a high cell count? Like, what's that number?
Basically, well, I can't speak for everyone, but for me personally, if she's over 200,000, I start to question what's going on. But anything below that, it's kind of one of those, well, is she like late in lactation or like what's going on?
Right. So does the milk hauler test for that?
No, the plant does.
The plant does.
But we also milk test once a month, and we kind of get personal high cell count cows, so that way we know who our problem cows are and who to milk last and all that fun stuff.
Can some cows just have high cell counts? Mm-hmm.
We've actually got one cow. She's got a high cell count, and like you'd never guess it because she milks out completely fine. Like, doesn't have any hard quarters, and it's like, what the heck's your problem?
I just remember, I don't know if it was one of the dairy farms that we were at, and the one cow just always had a high cell count. She just the way she was.
Yeah,
and it didn't matter if it was summer, winter, morning, night. It did not matter. It was just, you know, 250,000 or whatever. Good looking cow, milked well, just had a high cell count.
Yeah.
And that can affect, they can like dock you and stuff for that, mm-hmm. correct? Mm-hmm. If the overall herd is too high on a cell count.
Yeah. Yeah, which I think for us personally, I think you start getting docked at, it's either 200 or 250,000 that you start seeing a doc for your cell count.
It's one of those two numbers. Yeah. So that hasn't changed in the last 10 years. It looks like that's been the same across the board. Now, when you say that you test every month, what does that consist of?
It's the tester. She comes out and she has tubes that you hook up to the milking unit, and basically you're figuring out how much the cow itself is milking, and so she takes like the sample and sends it off to the lab, and when you get your information back, you figure out who has the high cell count, what cow is, like, what her fat and protein is, and how much she's milking. And basically, it just kind of gives you information of who's profitable and who do you kind of need to...
Each individual cow. Yeah. Because, like you said, they got their own separate tubes and stuff, and they just take a small sample, and then... Well, Rosie over here, this is her sample. And Dorothy over here, this is her sample.
Yep.
But they can break that down. Holy cow. I mean, they can tell you how much butter fat's in it and all that kind of stuff to go along with it. Do they still give, what's the word I'm looking for? If you have a higher butter fat content, do they still give you like an extra then on your milk that you sell to them? Or is it just now... industry standard across the board, this is what it is.
The co-op that we used to ship our milk to before it got bought out, they would basically, if you had high butter fat, they would pay you as much as they wanted. Whereas the co-op we switched to now, if no matter how high your butter fat is, you only top out at a dollar. Whereas before, you could get like $2 or $3 extra.
Wow.
Yeah.
But at least they're giving you, if you have a higher butter fat, at least they're giving you incentive to say, hey, keep that coming.
Yeah, if you've got a high butter fat, a high protein, low cell count, low plate count, and a low PI, you get incentive.
Yeah, because they, like I said, they can break that milk down to look at all of this different stuff, which is super incredible. Because, I mean, what I know... Some dairy farmers that have like a high butter fat and all that kind of stuff, well, some of that'll go to like cheese places, correct?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And they can make cheese works better from that kind of stuff, if I'm not mistaken.
Yeah.
So where if you have a lower butter fat count, then okay, we're just gonna use this for milk or cottage cheese or whatever. But this is gonna go up to Wisconsin cheese up there, and we're gonna make all this different cheese out of this stuff because of that high butter fat content.
Yeah. Yeah, there was when my parents moved out to the Adamson Road farm that we're on, and they were trying to find one of the co-ops. They actually had, I can't remember what their name is now, but they were really interested in us because the butter fat was so high, and then they realized we were only 50 cows, where this co-op, they wanted to come in with tankers, like, every day. It's like... Yeah, you're only going to get like 3,000 pounds out of us. Like, yeah, no, never mind.
Next time.
Yeah.
But 52 cows, that's a lot.
Yeah.
It really is.
Yeah.
It's the dairy industry is something that's, it seems to be going a lot more corporate.
Yeah. Yeah.
You don't see a lot of 50 cow dairy farms anymore.
No, it's a little disheartening because everyone just kind of looks at dairy farming as a paycheck, whereas we've got hopefully future plans to build a new facility, and everyone keeps asking me, like, do you want to expand? Do you want to expand? I'm like, not really. Like, I just want to be efficient. The highest I would ever want to get, if it came down to it, it's like 125, like maybe.
Well, if you get the other way to look at this, right, is you're used to milking 52 cows in a stall barn.
Yeah.
if you guys were to end up moving, building a different facility, whatever the case may be, now you can make that facility more efficient.
Yeah.
So now all of a sudden, okay, you might add on, let's just say you add on another 50 cows, right? Yeah. Well, maybe you're milking them with only another 45 minutes or another hour to your day. Well, if you can double your cows and only add 45 minutes or an hour onto your day, maybe that's worth it.
Yeah.
you'll cross that bridge when you get there.
Exactly.
And you know, you said you want to be efficient, and I can fully say this with 100% on this, but these bigger dairies are efficient.
Oh, I know. We actually went and I think it was Fair Oaks. We went toward when I was still in high school, and it was like
The one out in Indiana.
Yeah, and I think we stopped there on the way or to or from the FFA convention when it was out there, and they just it was so efficient. I'm like, I'm jealous.
Well, I just look at some of the dairy farmers that are just north of the state line.
Yeah.
And a lot of them have added on, tripled their herds, mm-hmm. quadrupled their herds over the last 10 years. And they're efficient. I mean, they got it down to a science. Yeah. They've got it figured out. Mm-hmm. Okay. You know, especially now with technology always improving, with automatic milkers and things like that, and now carousels and parlors and you can handle more cows and still be super efficient and productive as well.
Yep.
So I wasn't taking anything away from you saying that you want to be efficient, but I don't want to take anything away from them either, because they really are.
Yeah. Like they've done their homework. They deserve that credit. Like there is a couple farms that I go to, just like friends and stuff, and it's like, you guys are just really efficient.
But a lot of them aren't first generation dairy farmers either.
No.
So they grew up seeing their parents bust their ass and not be efficient and milk 40 cows and go, what are you doing that for? Mm-hmm. You know, let's spend a little money and let's do it this way.
Yeah.
And we'll milk 80 cows, still be super efficient.
Yeah.
There's just a lot that goes into it. Because, I mean, you guys also grow your own corn mm-hmm. for your cows. You grow your own hay for the cows. You grow the wheat and take the straw for the bedding for your cows. So it's not just about the cows. I mean, you are just about the cows.
Yeah.
That's what you want to be. That's where you shine, because you understand the cows. You know what you're looking for. You know what you want to do. And the rest of your family says, okay, Meredith, you handle the cows. We'll go create some awesome food for these guys so they can keep producing that milk, so on and so forth. It's a team effort, and but it's a lot of work.
It is, and it's everyone keeps asking us, like, why don't you just hire help? It's like, I'm not going to deny, I know we need help, but we're too small. Like, we just don't have enough for someone to be full-time. So either they get bored or we send them out to do stupid jobs that they end up getting mad at because they're like, well, what the hell? I don't want to do this. And it's like, yeah, I don't want to do it either. That's why I'm asking you.
But you're right. There comes to a point where you know you need help, but you're not big enough mm-hmm. to make it financially, to make a good financial decision to do that. So what do you do?
Yeah.
You either work harder, you work longer. Maybe you got some part-time guys you can call up and say, hey, you know, mom rolled her ankle the other day. I could use some help in the barn. Yeah. All right, I'll be down.
Yeah.
And I'm sure you guys have plenty of people to call and be able to do that with. But that still doesn't make it easier on the day-to-day stuff, the everyday stuff. It's like, man, I could, if I had three more arms, I'd be doing that stuff over there and that stuff over there. And because it's a time-consuming mm-hmm. occupation.
Yeah, and basically, no matter, like, whether it's efficient or not, like, farming is just, it's time consuming, like, especially when you're trying to do everything yourself and you've got like five irons in the fire over here and 10 over there. And it's just,
well, like you said earlier, you know, where they're like, hey, you got to get this license stuff done. And you're like, well, yeah, it's on the to-do list, but here's my to-do list here. I'll roll it out to you. You know?
Exactly.
And that's the thing. It's like, you guys could hire a full-time employee and keep them busy all the time.
Yeah.
There's no doubt about that in my mind. But do the finances work to be able to do that? That's the other problem that runs into it.
The other problem is people know that we're outdated facilities and it's back-breaking labor. Like, I'm 28 years old and I probably have the back of like an average 35, 40-year-old.
Hey, easy now.
Like, it's a lot of wear and tear.
Yeah, but you're right. It is. And I told you before we started, you know, milking really is a young person game.
Oh, yeah.
Especially in a facility like yours. Mm-hmm. You know, when you get into these bigger facilities and these updated facilities, okay, now it's not because you're not bending over all the time for it.
Yeah.
And the feed you're feeding outside. And so mm-hmm. that's all done with equipment. And you know, their bedding is all done with equipment then. Mm-hmm. You know, from bedding choppers and skid steers and mm-hmm. cleaning pens are all done. Not in your case. In the wintertime, you got to pitch. You got to pitch every stall when those cows are outside for them mm-hmm. 2 hours, mm-hmm. and then reshake up straw to put nice bedding back down. So when they come back in, and that's an everyday thing.
Mm-hmm. And then you got to feed them in, and then the feed that they don't eat overnight, you got to.
Clean up,
put that in the feed cart, put that back into the skid steer bucket to take it outside, and yeah, it's backbreaking labor, and it's a lot of times when you do hire help, they last for a couple months or so, and then you're just like, this is stupid. You're like, you're exactly right. It is stupid. I'm not going to blame you. Like
the difference is you just love it.
Yeah.
Yeah. And that's what makes it really hard is you don't want to give it up because you love to do it.
Mm-hmm.
So you got to make it work.
Yeah. Like I've always said, you don't choose the dairy industry. The dairy industry chooses you.
Which is true. Like, I believe that 100%.
You're either in it or you're out of it. Like you can't force yourself to like the cows if you don't like them. It's not wired that way.
Yeah, I'm not wired that way. Yeah, no. I've spent a lot of time in dairy farms throughout my life, and every time I'd walk in, I'm like, this is stupid. Like, these things are big, they're strong, they're heavy. You got to bend down to milk every damn – you got to bend down three times, bend down to clean the tit, bend down to put the milker on, and bend down to put the teat mm-hmm. dip on mm-hmm. every freaking cow. And when you want them to move, they don't have to move. If you know they're 1,100, 1,200 pound animal, and they're gonna look at you and go, "What are you doing, pipsqueak?"
Especially in my case, it's hilarious when everyone walks in the barn. They're just like, "Your cows are huge." I'm like, I think it's just me. I'm just short.
Well, we've been going for a while now, Meredith. We probably got to wrap this thing up. Thanks for the knowledge and talking about your farm and
oh, no problem.
And your passion and keep up on those classifications.
I'm trying.
Keep building that up.
Trying.
How you just, you know, and I want to bring that up too. If you do get your classifications and your pedigrees the way you want, that's extra income for the farm too.
It is, and that's kind of one of the things that I am trying to get just a little more pocket in my cash. No, cash in my pocket. Dyslexic, sorry.
But you're right. It comes down to, you know, everything that you guys do is for the cows, and the cows have to produce that milk in order for you guys to milk another day. And if all of a sudden you can start selling eggs out of a cow, all of a sudden, hey, boom. There's another source of income for this farm.
Yeah, which, like I said, I technically could probably start selling them, but...
That's up to you.
Yeah, it's up to me, and it's just one of those things, like, I know I'm not, I'm a no-name, so I just want to make sure that...
That doesn't mean anything in today's world. It really doesn't. I can tell you that because if you've got the product, they'll come.
Yeah.
Just like they say, you know, you build it, they will come. Same thing. Yeah. You're building your product now. If you're not 100% happy with your product, don't do it yet.
Yeah.
Wait until you're like, hey, this is it.
Yeah.
I got it now.
Yeah. And that's, I'm,
boom.
It's like, I'm right there. It's like, I know I've got good stuff, but I know I'm not quite there. We're right on the verge.
A little bit more.
Yeah, just a little bit more.
Hey, my hat's off to you. I wish you the best of luck.
Thank you.
Meredith, it's good to see you.
Good to see you
too. Until next time.